Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Game of Serfs, Book 3, by Michael Anderle, narrated by Todd Menesses. Chapter 1.
You ready?
Elaine didn't think she was. She was exhausted, despite a few hours of sleep and a ton of coffee. She suspected it was due to the mental strain of surviving a dragon attack. George still had his shoulder wrapped and one arm in a sling, but he was getting together everything they would need to escape. It wouldn't be difficult. Hengst was busy fielding calls and reports from all over the country, the last she heard. There was talk of his superiors recalling him to his post, whatever that meant. Plus, they were still trying to get a handle on where the dragon was. Escaping wouldn't be a problem. Staying away would be the problem.
Yeah,
she finally muttered as she peeked out of the cell. The soldiers on the small improvised base brought food and let them exercise in the open. Even with all the problems, nobody wanted a lawsuit for human rights violations. Aside from those two elements of their captivity, they were mostly left alone. George pressed against the bars, reaching for a small table next to his cell where someone had left a stack of papers. Nobody had time for paperwork these days. It took him some wiggling to fit his good shoulder through the gaps in his cell before he touched the stack of papers. He managed to pry a couple of paper clips from the pile. There were probably protocols about keeping tools of escape away from prisoners, but nobody was paying attention to protocol. George grunted softly, working the paper clips into the lock of his cell. It took him a few minutes, but he knew what he was doing. Before long, the lock clicked open.
You have to teach me how to do that,
Elaine whispered as he stepped out and started on her lock.
It's more time and patience than skill.
He worked faster now that he was on the right side of the door.
There is some theory I would teach when we have the time.
It seemed like a useful skill if she ever had time to pick it up. The door opened. She slipped out and checked on George's bandage before motioning for him to follow. The chaos of the retreat to safer areas left them enough room to sneak out of the base. Dozens of small farms created a patchwork of the area, all abandoned due to the military or the dragon. It was unfortunate for the owners, but it left George and Elaine with a means of escape. The nearest barn didn't have anything in it, but the next one had a dusty old truck with the keys inside. The owners probably hadn't expected anyone to steal it. Borrowed. They were borrowing it. They probably wouldn't be able to hand it back to the owners, but they'd abandon it somewhere on the road where someone could recover it. Maybe out of gas, but desperate times called for desperate measures. Elaine gritted her teeth as she started the truck, letting George climb into the passenger seat before she drove off. They didn't share another word during the drive, keeping a steady speed until the truck sputtered. They hadn't had time to stop at any gas stations and no money to pay for the fuel anyway. They abandoned the truck and walked, keeping an eye out for the rat creatures and their tusked buddies. Escaping had been too easy. As much as Elaine wanted to stay on the move, they needed to be careful. A police call reporting a stolen vehicle would raise the types of red flags Hengst would pounce on. If he still wanted them in custody. For all she knew, someone had carted him off to be yelled at by old men in suits over the waste of money and life he was responsible for. They found another car, this time abandoned on the side of the road. Elaine had no idea why the owner had left it there, but they weren't going to turn their backs on it. It started after some finagling. She had learned a couple of ways to hotwire a car, but the easiest ones were the older vehicles, where she could use a flathead screwdriver.
You think he's going to follow?
Elaine almost jumped when George spoke. Those were the first words exchanged between them in hours. Both needed time to recover from and process their trauma over having been so close to being killed by a dragon. Twice.
What?
Elaine played around with the stick shift. She'd learned to drive a manual transmission, but it had been a while, and she was having some trouble with it.
Hengst, we haven't been moving fast. I would have thought they would have caught up to us by now, but the area looks about as abandoned as it was since we started.
George grunted when they hit a pothole and jarred his wounds.
You think he's going to follow us, or will he let us go?
I don't know.
Elaine had been trying not to think about it.
I hoped he would have bigger fish to fry, but what little time I've spent with the asshole told me he's not strictly logical in his dealings. Whatever he does probably won't be what we expect.
How well do you know him?
Elaine shrugged.
Not well, which means probably as well as anyone knows him. Still, he has bigger problems to deal with now.
Problems out west? Yes.
George raised an eyebrow.
Yeah.
You think we should head out there if that's where he is?
Elaine sighed, watching the gas gauge and their stolen car go down steadily.
We have to. He could get recalled, leaving nothing to stop Naya from taking over Moab, except for the people already defending it.
Neither of them wanted to talk about it. The thought of facing Naya again made Elaine want to turn the car around, but there was no choice. Not for her, anyway. George could probably duck out whenever he wanted, but Naya had killed most of his family and friends. He didn't have much to return to, so he stuck with her. That would probably change during the lengthy trip to Moab, but she appreciated the company, even if he was quiet most of the time. It didn't take long for this car to run out of gas, which left them with no option but to walk again. She still had some reserve funds, and she could transfer them into the account linked to her U.S. debit card once they got to a computer somewhere, but for the moment, stealing cars or walking were their only options. Thankfully, Elaine spotted a farmhouse not too far down the road.
We might want to get some food there, George muttered. See about changing these bandages? Doc said they needed to be changed regularly or risk infection.
Elaine nodded, shading her eyes with her hand to get a better view. The place looked abandoned, although farming implements and cars were still out in the open. Its occupants had probably abandoned it quickly. That, or they were dead. Between the dragons and the monsters popping up, either was possible. Elaine couldn't help but feel bad about scavenging through the landscape. There wasn't much else they could do, but it was difficult to avoid knowing they were trespassing on someone's property. A family home, from the looks of the toys left in the yard.
What's the matter?
George picked up on her hesitation.
I don't know. It seems wrong to pilfer from these places,
she shrugged.
They might all be dead already for all we know. The stuff here will do us a hell of a lot more good than it'll do them.
I know.
She sighed and wiped the sweat from her forehead. It was unseasonably warm, and Elaine had begun to think the dragons might have something to do with that.
It just feels wrong, that's all.
George nodded.
Think we should move on?
No point. It'll feel wrong in the next place, and the one after that. Assuming we don't accidentally stumble on a meth lab or something.
He nodded for her to follow. Elaine didn't want to ask whether he knew a thing or two about that. Maybe that was why he was amused by what she said. She pushed the front door open and headed into the house. It looked like it couldn't have been vacant for more than a few days. There was still some food in the pantry. A first aid kit in the bathroom allowed her to change George's bandages. She found some painkillers, too. He was putting on a brave face, but the way he clenched his jaw with every step told her he was in pain. A couple of NSAIDs helped, though. They cooked a quick meal with what remained in the cupboards and collected more they could travel with. Whoever owned the house had a sweet tooth or wanted to have a lot of snacks on hand for the kids. It was excellent travel food. Still, Elaine didn't have it in her to spend the night in any of the beds.
You don't want to sleep in the house, huh?
George muttered.
Nope.
I have that same bad feeling, like the owners are going to come back and put us in a Goldilocks situation.
That wasn't quite her concern, but Elaine nodded anyway. It seemed like she was carving away her staunch morals one stroke at a time. It was always out of necessity, but doing shit she never thought she'd do had become an everyday occurrence.
It started with stealing a military vehicle to escape custody, and snowballed from there.
There should be some rooms in the barn we can use.
George fought back a yawn.
You know, something they have ready if one of their hands needs a place to crash. Not all farms have it, but most do.
I'll bow to your superior knowledge on the matter.
She smiled and let him lead the way. They packed all their pilfered items in duffel bags and headed to the barn. There were a couple of rooms attached to one side. No bathrooms, and in any other spring, they would have been awfully cold. Elaine would have been happy to take a warm shower before she went to bed, but after a decent meal and a long day on the run, the sight of the narrow, lumpy bed and iffy pillow made her exhaustion catch up. She almost wished it hadn't. The nightmares had come every night. Elaine shivered, feeling herself slipping into the nightmare. She was usually good at keeping a handle on her few nightmares, but they had a more powerful draw these days. She couldn't avoid them. It was all darkness around her. Elaine breathed harder, feeling the heat warning her of Naya's presence. She felt and heard the laughter in the back of her mind. The connection was established again, the mockery grating at her and bringing cold sweat as she looked around for a weapon, any weapon.
You think you can stop me?
Elaine clapped her hands over her ears as she screamed. She knew the voice wasn't external, but it was instinctive to protect herself the way she might have thousands of years before. All she could do was sprint away as fast as her suddenly sluggish legs could carry her. It was like a power held her back, slowing and tiring her beyond all reality, leaving her nothing to fight back with. The heat of the dragon's breath on her back alarmed her, the sound of the scales shuddering, a tongue gliding lightly over massive teeth which she could all but see in her mind's eye, waiting to cut her in half. With a low roar, the fire pelted her skin. Elaine tried to scream, but nothing came out. All she could hear was the roar of the flames crisping her skin, melting into her muscles and tearing her body apart with the sheer heat. She snapped up, still screaming, and scrambled from the bed where the musty sheets were all tangled around her limbs. Her skin was still sweaty, cooling her when she settled back on the bed, but her raw throat told her she had been screaming for a while. There was no sign the dream was anything more than a dream. She wasn't sure why she needed to check for burns every damn time, but the dragon injuring her through her dreams was a terrifying concept. One she wished she'd never thought of. She was surprisingly warm, though. Elaine blinked a few times and looked down to see a pair of arms. Not an unfamiliar sight when she was in college, but she hadn't expected it out in the boonies.
George?
The alternative was that a stranger snuck into bed with her, but she already knew it was him. The scent was familiar enough, as was the contour of his arms, even in the darkness.
Yeah, he pulled back. Sorry, you were thrashing around and screaming. I tried to hold you in, is all.
That's fine, she whispered, suddenly cold when he withdrew. Thanks.
No problem.
He cleared his throat, rose from the bed, and headed toward the door. Why did she want to ask him to stay? The words were on her lips, but he was already out, heading back to his bed. Elaine resettled herself and scowled in the darkness. It took her longer than she would have liked to get back to sleep. It looked like she'd gotten a solid 6 hours, and the sun was only starting to appear on the horizon when she woke up again. She slipped out of her room and headed into the main house. All thoughts of how she might be stealing someone's life were gone as she settled in for a lukewarm shower. It was way better than nothing. Getting off all the sweat and grime from their day's traveling felt good, almost better than the restless sleep she'd gotten. Combined with some coffee she'd seen in the pantry, it would prepare her for the day ahead. George stepped into the kitchen when she was pouring the coffee. He looked like he needed a shower too, and they drank the coffee in silence. She was halfway through changing his bandages again when he finally spoke up in a hoarse voice.
You too, huh?
Elaine steeled herself, closing her eyes for a second.
Yeah.
George winced when she pressed the new bandage on his burns. They looked like they were healing, but it was still a slow, painful process. He was out of the hypothermia stage of recovery, although his hands were clammier than before. When they heard movement outside, they rose to their feet. Elaine wasn't worried that the owners were returning. It was possible, but they would have heard the sound of a vehicle before they heard footsteps. What they heard had to be more scavengers, or worse. She stepped out of the building and narrowed her eyes when she saw small, hunched figures approaching the house. The trio looked bloodied and battered, but their shapes were unmistakable. Elaine grabbed a shovel leaning against the side of the house. The rat creatures seemed as surprised to see her as she was to see them. They must have been looking for a place to stay for the rest of the day, trying to avoid the blazing sun. They moved slower than she was used to, but they jumped forward to attack anyway. Elaine slammed the shovel into the gut of the nearest one, then brought it crashing down on the head of one coming in behind. The last one tried to jump away, but Elaine lunged forward, knocked its feet out from under it, and smashed the shovel on the creature's head. One was still alive, and Elaine was not in the mood for it to run off and bring back a horde of its buddies. She beat the downed rat creature's head with the shovel so hard that it snapped the head off the haft and left her with a piece of wood in her hand. It was still a decent weapon, better than her fist. Elaine felt a moment of separation, as if she hadn't done those things and hadn't killed the creatures. When she returned to the house, George stood at the door with a kitchen knife.
We're heading west to deal with the dragon in Moab again, huh?
He whispered. Elaine studied his face. It was as stony as ever, but she heard the stark terror he tried to keep hidden in his voice. She knew it because she felt it too.
I think that's our only choice,
Elaine finally whispered and drew a deep breath.
I feel like if we try to run away, we'll end up drawn back. Running away will haunt us later as much as it is now. It might get worse over time.
Yeah,
he sniffed and looked at the knife in his hand.
I guess you're right. No point hanging around. Let's get a move on.
Chapter 2. There were a lot of problems Benjy was prepared for when fantasy became reality. Granted, it was in role-playing games, but dealing with goblins, orcs, and dragons, training soldiers, prepping fortifications, and finding ways to understand the magic that infused the lair were all part of his previous campaigns. Although the latter few were usually remanded to one or two sentences, if he was the DM. There was no point bogging his players down in the realities of their situation. A hint of realism kept them grounded and invested in the game world. One thing that rarely came up was food. There was no magical lembus, nothing that would fill the stomach of a grown man with one bite. No, only regular-assed food. There was the matter of it being mystically and magically maintained and kept fresh, despite having been there for thousands of years. It was normal, aside from that.
Did you hear what I said?
Marty asked. He blinked a few times, realizing that his mind had wandered.
I'm sorry, no. My brain went away for a second there.
What were you saying? Talking about our food situation, remember?
Benjy nodded. That was what had caused his mind to go off on a tangent.
Right.
He cleared his throat and looked around at the others.
Talking about how we keep finding storerooms with more food, but we can't expect them to last forever, not with more people coming in. That was about when I lost focus.
We can do this on our own, you know.
The older man commented with an annoying amount of deference in his voice.
There's no need to keep you if you have more important things to do.
Nothing's more important than keeping everyone in our little sanctuary fed.
Benjy cut in. Jenny leads most of the hunting parties to clear out any remaining orcs and escort any survivors back. If she needs my help, she'll call.
They would have to find where their water came from and how reliable it was, but food was the biggest concern for the moment. They had gone through much more of it over the past few days than he thought, and they couldn't rely on what remained of their statues to keep finding new storerooms with more food. Mostly because the same rat-like creatures that had failed to turn fully into goblins infested three of those they'd discovered.
I appreciate that.
The man's face brightened and he stroked his mustache pensively.
I told young Marty that I work for the Department of Agriculture.
Right, Benjy muttered. You told us about how many pigs there were in the country, and how many we could expect to turn into orcs. What was your name again?
Ellis Maxwell. I've done land management in my day. If you could spare the time and people, we might be able to scout the land around the mountain and see if we can't set up some irrigation for farms and livestock.
Irrigation?
Benjy raised an eyebrow.
Will we have to start tapping the sanctuary's water supply?
I don't think so,
Ellis muttered and pulled out a couple of maps.
There's Fisher Creek here, flowing out of Dolores River. That's the nearest, but we might need more water. We can tap Onion Creek down here. It's a start anyway.
He had good ideas. Benjy crossed his arms and studied the map. He didn't like leading people that far out of the lair in case more orcs and goblins came, but they needed to think about their food situation in the long term.
All right,
Benjy nodded.
I'll talk to Connor and put some people together who can ride. You can ride, right?
Sure.
Good. We'll stay mobile and get an idea of what we can do and how quickly we can start setting farms up.
Excellent,
the older man beamed.
I'll get my tools and meet you out front.
Benjy nodded as the man went off with an extra pep in his step, then faced Marty.
Right. Connor is still drilling the teams out front, right?
Yep.
He drew a deep breath and nodded.
Time to start acting like a responsible adult, I guess. Do you think you can come with us? Maybe we can figure out some spells that might help with the process of growing the food?
They were dealing with an unseasonably warm spring. He assumed that had something to do with the dragons, but he had no idea how that would affect crops or livestock.
I guess it couldn't hurt,
Marty agreed as they headed out front, where they heard Connor drilling their recruits. Some had come in with firearms, and while he wanted to rely on those as much as possible, there was a shortage of rounds for them. Better to have the people prepared with the weapons they would be using once the ammo ran out. Marty had talked about trying to replicate the spells on the quivers of arrows and bolts that could self-replicate on bullets instead, but stated it would be months of study before he could begin to attempt it. Considering bullets were a lot more volatile than arrows, and the gunpowder might go off with one misspoken word, Benjy wasn't going to rush him.
Morning, sir.
Connor greeted them when they arrived at where the groups were training.
The new folks are settling in nicely. I think they appreciate having something to do when they get here. Most were surprised when I suggested they start strapping on armor and using shields, but they got used to it quickly.
Benjy nodded, noting a few looking in his direction. He wasn't comfortable with it, so he ignored them.
Anything you need?
Connor asked.
Or were you coming to check on the recruits?
We're going to scout the area around the mountain, Benjy explained. Look into getting some farms working. Marty and I will be heading out, and we could use six others. Those who can ride the best, I think.
I'll have them ready and on horses in 10,
Connor jumped to attention and yelled six names as Benjy headed off to get Dawn Chaser ready for the ride. Marty was ready sooner than he was, and so were the six riders. An extra horse was available for Ellis Maxwell, who showed himself an able horseman.
"Lead the way, Mr. Maxwell,"
Benjy ensured he had his weapons and armor ready if he needed them. He'd started practicing with a bow, and as much fun as it was, he still had some difficulty shooting from horseback. It would have to wait. Maxwell started them down the pathways, heading south at first, even though they would end up circling north. There were mountains to the north they wanted to avoid, and their travels would be a lot gentler if they stuck to the roads.
"Might be we can run a canal from Onion Creek. See how it cuts north from the Colorado? That'll give us enough water."
Ellis let his horse do most of the work in navigating the winding trails headed north.
"We'd have to put in a canal as quickly as possible."
"Marty," Benjy asked, "you brought a whole layer up out of the mountain. How do you feel about putting in a canal to connect two creeks?"
His court mage didn't look convinced about the idea.
"There was a lot of desperation in what I did, and even then, there were 100,000 ways it could have gone wrong. Still, I can look at the place and see if there's a way I can do it. We might need to be ready to apply some good old-fashioned elbow grease, though."
Benjy was afraid of that. Relying too heavily on magic when they didn't know enough about what it cost to use was probably a bad idea. He tried to help Marty as much as possible with the translating. Truth was, he was trying to do a lot of things at the same time. Jenny kept telling him it would burn him out, but everyone kept looking at him like he was something else. Something more. Benjy didn't like that, and for some reason it had him trying to prove he was everything they expected him to be. Rushing from one corner of the lair, castle now, he supposed, to the other wasn't doing anyone any good, and it would be best if he found something to focus on. Maybe farming would be the thing. Not that he knew anything about farming. Benjy shook his head.
No. A few Google searches told him that the best aspect a leader could have was the ability to delegate. There were more and more people available for him to delegate to. The rest of the riders looked like they were ready for anything. One had a double-barreled shotgun in a saddle scabbard, but they all carried swords, shields, and crossbows collected from the armory. Benjy didn't know if anyone had magical quivers, but they would be ready to put down a smaller troop of orcs. If they spotted a larger troop approaching, they were mobile enough to get away before they got swarmed. Benjy wanted to see if Connor had been instructing them on how to battle from horseback, but hopefully they wouldn't have to find out today. He was surprised to find that their escort took their job seriously and with some competence. A couple of them might have had some military experience, and they all rode like it was something they'd been doing since before they could walk. His connection with Dawn gave him something of an edge, but Benjy knew he was a long way from their innate skill with the horses Dawn had picked out for them. Dawn snorted and tossed his mane, seeming to disagree with his thinking, but there was nothing for it. They'd been riding their whole lives. Dawn was the first horse he'd ever ridden. They were approaching one of the creeks, and Marty and Ellis talked it over.
"Spell work might not work," Marty shook his head. "I mean, I can try, but simultaneously working up earth and water magic feels like it will go wrong. What I might be able to do is one or the other. Could we hold back the water and maybe let the statues do the digging while everyone else sets up the braces?"
"That sounds like a decent plan."
Ellis sounded like someone being able to use magic to divert the flow of water was the most normal thing he'd ever heard of.
"Working fast is the key. We want to keep the water moving, or any damming will flood the region."
"Is that a bad thing?"
"In this dry land? It'll wash away all the topsoil before we can use it for farming."
"Got movement up ahead,"
one of the escorts shouted. Benji's mind was wandering again. but he snapped to attention. His hand was already on his sword's hilt when he saw what caused the movement. There were goblins in the trees. They didn't like being caught out in the open, not when cover was available. Someone or something had roughed up this troop. There were fewer of them, for one thing. They liked to have the advantage of numbers in any engagement, which usually meant swarms of them hidden in the trees, waiting to catch someone in their traps. In this case, there were only 15 of them, maybe a few more hidden off the road, but most were out in the open. They sported wounds, too, fresh ones still bleeding. Benjy would have guessed that they got in trouble with a clutch of orcs, but among the injuries were burns on their skin. Bright, red, angry burns, which told him something else was going on. The last hint was that they seemed genuinely afraid. There were none of the hungry looks they usually got when dealing with them. Benjy still drew his sword and watched the group carefully. The rest of the escort had their crossbows aimed. Marty had his spear. He called it a staff, ready to cast spells if needed. Even Ellis had a sword in hand.
"Not food,"
one of the goblins shouted, motioning for the rest of the goblins to back away.
"Not food. Pleading, not food."
His previous interactions told him the goblins associated any killing with food and tended to get the two words confused. They weren't eating their wounded. Considering how they were all wounded, it made sense. Benjy raised his free hand to keep his people from attacking. Every time he did that, he assumed someone would ignore him, thinking they knew better. Hell, maybe they did. After his last dealings with the goblins, trusting them seemed like a bad idea.
"This land isn't safe for your kind anymore," Benjy growled, nudging Dawn to take a few steps ahead of the rest of the party. "Not after your people tried to kill mine. But I'm in a merciful mood. Clear these lands at once and you can leave with your lives."
There was a quick conversation among the goblins as a few translated what Benjy said to those who couldn't speak the language. They talked back and forth before one turned to him.
"Not leave,"
the goblin said.
"Can't leave. Fire wings make food from goblins. Run. Must leave, but not leave."
He tilted his head, trying to determine what the hell they were talking about. Firewing seemed pretty intuitive, though. He presumed they were talking about dragons from the burns a few goblins sported. They were not in the mood to fight and wanted to be allowed to run away from their attackers. That was his assumption, anyway. Jenny was better at translating the goblins' take on the English language, and he wished she'd come with him on this. He wished that a lot lately.
"Look for sleep place,"
the goblin continued, with nods of agreement coming from the rest of the goblins.
"Need sleep place. Not leave until sleep place."
He didn't like it. He didn't trust the creatures, not after almost getting killed when they turned him over to the orcs. But if they were running from a dragon, it was already close. Benjy motioned for Marty to join him at the front. His mage didn't look happy about getting so close to the goblins, but he complied, scowling at the creatures.
"What do you think?"
Benjy whispered. The creatures' long ears flicked and leaned closer like they were trying to eavesdrop. It didn't matter, not if he had them at his mercy. He still wanted to keep his deliberations a secret from them.
"What do I think?" Marty hissed. "You're thinking of trusting the bastards?" "If there's a dragon in the region, we need more intelligence on it."
Benjy leaned closer.
"I don't mean to say we should trust them, but if they can provide us with intelligence, I think we can afford to allow them a place to rest and recover for the night before heading off to wherever they're going."
"What if they connect with a larger troop of the bastards who think they can give the location of our lair?"
Marty countered.
"Or if they tell others about what we're doing."
Benjy raised his hand to stop Marty from saying anything else and tapped his ear. He didn't know if the goblins could hear them, but no point in risking it. Marty made a good point. but as long as they didn't say anything else, all the goblins could tell was that they were another scouting party. Marty conceded.
If they have intelligence on a dragon in the area, we might be able to allow them some shelter, as long as they're under watch and escorted off our lands as quickly as possible.
That was reasonable enough, and Benjy turned his attention back to the waiting goblins.
You will tell us everything you know about the dragon,
Benjy announced, feeling a thrill of magic coming from his words, raising goosebumps across his skin.
Once you do, you will be allowed temporary shelter and time to recover before leaving these lands never to return.
The second quick conference among the goblins ended faster than the first one, and their speaker turned back to him.
Can trust?
Benjy snorted. That was pretty rich of them to ask, but he supposed the idea of irony would be lost on them.
You have no choice but to trust.
Chapter 3.
People think I'm dead? Yes, ma'am.
The young woman in uniform nodded, her expression grim.
You haven't streamed in a hot minute. In these uncertain times, I guess you can't blame people for thinking that, even if you managed to get some random post on social media.
Elaine had been afraid of that. While it was a good way to keep Hengst off her trail, if people didn't see her streaming as often, they wouldn't pay the fees for her sites, and her income would be affected. It wasn't something she'd thought about much when she was running and fighting for her life, but she had a career to attend to, and it was languishing. Still, it was good to know she still had the support of some of the military.
I'll see about starting the streams again.
Elaine took her fake ID back from the officer's hands.
Most of my equipment got messed up, so I'll be starting from scratch. I hope to find a way to make it work again, though.
You've been telling people what's happening around the country when nobody else is.
The woman shrugged. She looked around and noted that none of her superiors had appeared.
Still, I understand you're staying low. Word is there's an arrest warrant out on you. Something to keep in mind, you know. We always appreciate hearing from you. Carry on.
The last two words were spoken loudly in an official tone, allowing them to keep moving along the road. There were checkpoints set up all over the country. Elaine appreciated that the military was doing something to contain the monsters pillaging the landscape. However, it made moving across said landscape without being detected that much more difficult. The tusk and rat monsters were making things complicated too, turning the highways into a war zone where nobody dared move without a heavy escort. That left the smaller side roads, forcing them to get creative and cut across fields, sometimes to avoid the military checkpoints. She couldn't count on friendlies being there to help every time. They couldn't run from all the checkpoints either. What should have been only a couple of days on the road was turning into a slog.
Seems people know about you,
George pointed out. He'd been silent during the stop, keeping any thoughts about Elaine's celebrity status to himself.
It wasn't my intention when I started.
Elaine put the car in gear. Who knew so many cars in the country were stick shift? She was getting better at driving them, but still.
I don't know what my intention was when I first started. I was flying by the seat of my pants and ended up with people listening in. I wasn't much more than a middling freelance reporter before all this started. Don't get me wrong, I'm one of the best, but it's usually about the people you know in the journalism biz. I didn't know any of the right people.
George grunted something unintelligible, and Elaine settled into the humdrum task of driving. They'd kept the same car for most of the day, but they would probably have to give it up after the traffic stop. Even if they got through clean, Hengst might pick them up on the camera footage. There was no point in risking it. She transferred some of her reserves and withdrew them as cash so they could buy what they needed at the next rest stop, but the remaining civilian communities were islands in a sea of chaos and uncertainty. Even those places presented issues to a pair of fugitives under martial law.
We might be able to pick up a camera or something when we get to the next place.
She wanted to let people know she was alive. If they knew she was still out there and streaming, all would be well, or at least better. Then she could focus on getting to Moab.
You still have some recording equipment, George pointed out. You might not be able to stream live, but you can record a video. Tell people you're still with them, and there's no need to panic yet. Their intrepid hero journalist is still among them.
She smirked at him, noticing they were coming up on another one of the little islands of civilization.
Nothing to it. Sure, I can record stuff, but I think the towers are getting attacked. They were trying to put in the effort to connect even the most remote regions of the country, but they can't defend all the towers, and they're going down now.
He grunted again. He did that more often lately, as if he were returning to himself. His wounds were healing, and he had some good painkillers to work through the remaining aches. George knew the protocol and gathered their meager bags of supplies and personal belongings they'd collected when they escaped incarceration. It wasn't much, but Elaine was glad they had recovered her tape recordings of George talking about his stompers. It seemed like a good idea to tell people there were folks out there who had been fighting the good fight against dragons. A lot of guns awaited them as they drove into the little town. Defenses had been set up all along the perimeter, with towers built at intervals that would give the people inside some warning when they were about to be attacked. Elaine was thankful the roads remained open. That hadn't always been the case over the past couple of days, traveling west, and she'd needed to talk people into lowering improvised drawbridges and the like to let them drive through. People were paranoid these days, with every right to be. She wished there could be more unity in the face of a common enemy instead of isolating and hiding out in bunkers.
Wait, George growled and shook his head. You said the towers are coming down?
Yeah.
Do you think the tusk and rat creatures know what they're attacking while taking them down or destroying them for the sake of destruction?
Elaine shook her head.
Neither.
Huh?
I don't think the tusks or the rats are destroying the towers.
Elaine shrugged.
Dragons. Smaller than Naya, but still a threat. From what I know about them, they're intelligent enough to know there's something to those towers and might understand what they're for. Failing that, it's almost like they're offended that we apes dare to build anything without their permission or something. Fuckers are arrogant to their last breath, and they don't like our species.
Figures, considering the first to show its face decided to wreck four cities.
He had a point there, but Parlu Khan seemed to be an exception. He wanted to rule over the world. None of them knew what Naya wanted with the power or what she would be capable of if she got it. That thought alone was enough to spur Elaine to move quicker. They were coming up to a gas station.
I'll see about getting us a new car.
She pulled her bag over her shoulder.
Doesn't look like there's a military presence around, but if you hear or see anything, give me two short honks and I'll come running.
We've gone over this.
I know, just making sure.
With the painkillers he was on, it was best to keep double-checking. Elaine climbed out of the car and inspected it for a few seconds. It wouldn't get them anything decent in a trade, but she could put up about $5,000 to cover the difference. If they needed to pay that much, the car would have to last them the rest of the way to Moab.
Morning to you, the owner of the gas station grumped.
Elaine saw the shotgun he kept under the counter, but he put up the pretense of being an active business.
Looking to get some gas?
I think so,
Elaine smiled.
Where are the two of you headed, if you don't mind my asking?
The man chuckled softly.
Don't mind me if you don't want to answer. I know plenty of people want to keep what they're doing to themselves.
Oh.
Elaine cleared her throat and looked back at the car.
Headed to Moab.
Moab, huh?
The man nodded.
Lots of folks headed there these days.
Military?
Elaine didn't want any attention, but it was a reasonable assumption, considering what Hengst knew.
Not really. Mostly civilians. Talk of a sanctuary up there. Talking about people setting up a king since the government ain't sending anyone. Sounds like garbage to me, but they keep coming. Had two caravans come through here the other day, all headed to Moab, following family members or some such. Will that be with cash or credit?
Huh?
Elaine blinked. Civilians going to Moab? That couldn't be right. Not if they knew it was where Parlukan originally rose from the earth.
Cash or credit? Figure we're one of the last places in the country that still take credit cards, aside from the bigger cities.
Oh, cash.
She shook her head. She needed to start acting like she was in hostile territory. Mostly because she was.
Also, and I don't know if this is the place for me to ask, but my buddy and I have been looking to upgrade the car. It still drives, but it wasn't quite what we were looking for. Do you know of anyone who might be willing to make an exchange for it?
The man behind the counter scowled before leaning over and taking a closer look at the car.
That there bucket of bolts you're driving?
It's a Honda from the 90s,
Elaine explained.
Doesn't have much in the way of modern comforts, but if you treat it right, that car will outlive you and your children, most likely.
Don't have children.
He seemed to realize that wasn't the question, but shrugged.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.